Hello, my friends, and welcome to the Seeds and Weeds Podcast, brought to you by Small House Farm. Join us as we talk with gardeners, foragers, herbalists, chefs, and community activists to explore the many ways that plants impact our cultures and cuisines, our history, and our future. I'm your host, Bevan Cohen, and this is Seeds and Weeds. Howdy, friends. Welcome back to the show. We got a great episode for you today. Gardening expert Susan Mulvihill is going to be joining us to answer your gardening questions. If you struggle with squirrels and rabbits in your garden, or you got too much clay in your soil, or if you're curious about what types of fruits and vegetables can be grown in the shade, Susan's going to be answering all those questions and more. So be sure to stick around for that. In Small House News, my new book, The Heritage Pantry, is now available for pre-order. You know, this book was a lot of fun to work on, and you can pre-order your copy today at smallhousefarm.com. Books are going to start shipping out around May 15th. Now, here's the sales copy description of the book. In The Heritage Pantry, Bevan writes about a variety of preservation techniques, dehydrating, fermenting, freezing, pickling, and smoking, as well as making jams, jellies, and marmalades. He also includes chapters on using salt, fats, and sugar to brine, cure, and candy foods. A compelling blend of memoir and cookbook, The Heritage Pantry offers historical perspectives on the techniques, information on how each is accomplished, lists of the equipment needed, tips for success, and plenty of recipes. The Heritage Pantry, modern methods of preserving food the old-fashioned way. Now, it's not available on Amazon or anywhere else like that yet, so you're going to want to visit smallhousefarm.com to place your order. Oh, and guess what? That link down in the show notes. Quick shout out to our community over on Patreon. We are so thankful for your continued support that allows us to keep producing the podcast. Not only do our patrons keep Seeds and Weeds on the air, they also enjoy a ton of perks and benefits like free garden seeds, seasonal gift baskets, and access to our exclusive herb co-op. Big thanks to the 12 new patrons that have joined since our last episode, including Karina Richmond. Thank you all for supporting the show. If you'd like to join our Patreon community, you can find that link down in the show notes or at seedsandweedspodcast.com. This episode is also brought to you in part by our friends at Garden Joy, the garden game that lets you explore your love for plants, seasons, horticulture, and outdoor design. With Garden Joy, designing stunning settings for your flower garden is not only fun, but also relaxing. Explore your creativity and design the garden of your dreams right now. While you play, you'll learn about plants, seasons, and outdoor design. You can find Garden Joy in your app store or visit gardenjoygame.com. Susan Mulvihill is a gardener, educator, author, and host of the popular Susan's in the Garden YouTube channel. Susan's passionate about gardening, and she believes that everyone should be able to grow a great garden. Her latest book, The Vegetable Garden Problem Solver Handbook, is now available through Cool Springs Press. And today, Susan's joining us on the podcast to answer your gardening questions. Susan, thank you so much for joining us on the show today.
Thanks for having me, Bevan.
I am really excited about this. I appreciate you taking the time to come on the program to share your gardening wisdom with everybody and answer some of the questions that have been submitted by our listeners.
I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
Now, before we jump into those questions, though, your latest book, The Vegetable Garden Problem Solver Handbook, it recently won a 2024 American Horticultural Society Book Award. So, of course, first off, congratulations. That's a big deal. That's huge.
Thank you. It was a wonderful surprise.
Now, could you tell us a little bit about this award-winning book of yours?
Sure. So it just came out last year, and I initially wrote The Vegetable Garden Pest Handbook, which is all about insects, both beneficial ones and the damaging types that we deal with in our gardens. That came out in 2021. And then my publisher suggested that maybe I write a book that's only about vegetable garden plant diseases. And at the time I thought, gosh, I don't know if I could write a whole book about that. And so I started thinking about all of the different kinds of challenges that we gardeners have. And it could be critters in the garden. It could be, you know, germination and pollination issues, crazy weather. I mean, everybody's dealing with that nowadays. Plant disorders. So things like blossom end rot or sun scald. Why did that happen? Pollination issues, germination issues, different things like that. There's just so many little things that can happen. And I thought, if I put this all together in one guide, since I've already done the book on bugs, I thought that that would be a really helpful companion book for gardeners.
I loved it. You know, you are definitely the perfect person to have on the show today. So our listeners have submitted a bunch of different questions about their gardens, all sorts of different stuff. And we need an expert to help answer them. And I think you're perfect for the job.
I hope I'm up to it.
Now, the first couple of questions that we got here, they're about pesky critters in the garden. So Karina Richmond asks, how can she keep rabbits away from her vegetable crops? In particular, they seem to be eating her beets, her dill, and even her rosemary plants.
I just think that's not very nice. You know, rabbits are a challenging critter, but at least for the most part, they stay on the ground. You know, there are bird pests and there's squirrel pests that are more mobile. And so at least rabbits are maybe a little bit easier to control. So to be honest, the easiest way to keep them away from your crops is to create some type of a wire barrier around the perimeter of the area you want to protect. Now, I realize if you have a huge garden, that's a pretty large undertaking, but the barrier should be 2 feet tall. At least that's not super tall. And you also want to have 6 inches of wire underground just in case they try to dig under it. There's also chicken wire cages that you can buy or you can make your own and then grow the most susceptible crops underneath them. Now, there are some types of commercial rabbit repellents, but the thing you want to know when you're dealing with your garden veggies and fruits and so on, is that you always want to check the label before you buy a product to make sure it's safe to use around the edible crops. And then one other possibility, which is actually has a bit of a humorous part to it. So there is something called a motion activated sprinkler. And what you do is you hook it up to a hose, you put it in the area that you're trying to protect. If you've set it up to cover a certain area with the motion sensor, if something moves in that area, it's going to shoot a strong jet of water. Just make sure that if you're going to work in your garden, you remember to turn it off or you're going to get a really nasty surprise.
Now, Debbie Gambino from Wyandotte, Michigan, she's got a similar type of a question, but she's actually asking about squirrels. She's having an issue with squirrels that are digging up her seedlings and tubers and bulbs. I guess they're digging up everything. What can she do about it?
Oh, boy. And, you know, squirrels are so challenging. So first thing I want to mention is don't put out food for the squirrels because that just keeps them coming back to your yard. If you're not a gardener, you are making the gardeners around you pretty mad. And if you are a gardener, it's perpetuating the problem. Even if you put out food that's just for the squirrels and they're liking certain crops in your garden, they don't know the difference between what food is okay for them to eat versus what you're trying to grow for yourself. So keep that in mind. You might need to use a chicken wire cage or something around your vegetable garden or other area of your garden where they're giving her a lot of problems. And the other thing is that squirrels do not like aromatic plants. So things like marigolds, nasturtiums, garlic, or onions. So if you interplant them with the plants that they are really bothering, that is a good way to keep them away from them. Once again, you can look for an organic animal repellent. They are out there, and be sure to apply it according to the label directions. You could also go with the motion activated sprinkler, like I mentioned earlier. And then another idea is to use hoops and floating row cover or agricultural insect netting over the crops that are really being bothered by the squirrels, except if they need to be pollinated, that's a problem. So if it isn't something that needs to be pollinated, that would work well, provided you weigh down the edges of whatever cover you use so that they can't sneak underneath it.
We've had a few questions from folks about growing in the shade. Angelina Royal from Missoula, Montana. She's got a big maple tree from her neighbors that's kind of shading out a good portion of her yard. So she wants to know if you have a nice list of some great plants that she can grow right in the shade.
Okay, I do. Naturally, the more sun you can give the plants, the better. But it's such a frustrating problem because the tree roots are probably also being attracted to the water that's in her yard. And so that makes it super challenging. I was going to suggest a couple things before I mentioned some vegetable and fruits that she could grow. One thing is that you might need to use like elevated raised beds or some type of raised beds with wire underneath. But I will say that tree roots are really good at getting to a source of water. Another idea is if she has a sunny patio or front porch or deck or something, she might consider growing some veggies or flowers in containers there. So that's some potential options. But as far as vegetable crops that will tolerate some shade, I do have a bit of a list here. So things like beets, broccoli, cabbage, carrots, celery, chard, kale, kohlrabi, leeks, lettuce, pak choy, spinach, and turnips. So that's quite a few different types of veggie crops. And I will say they do need at least a little bit of sunlight. So hopefully she has maybe some early morning sun or some late afternoon sun, something like that. Now, as far as fruit bearing plants that will tolerate some shade, you can grow currants, gooseberries, lingonberries, and elderberries.
Well, that's quite a list of stuff that you could still grow in the shade then. A lot of different options there.
Yeah, not too bad. I mean, you know, I know how discouraging it is if you don't have enough sunlight to grow things. So there are a lot of different types of plants that will tolerate some shade. So I think it's definitely worth her experimenting with them and seeing how they do.
It's kind of fun when you're trying something new like that, because she might be able to pick some vegetables off that list that she's never even grown before. So trying something really new.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, Desi Ferguson, she's hoping you got some advice for her on how to improve her clay soil. Now, she says she's tried amending it for the last couple of years. She's used leaves and compost, but the soil gets all dried out and baked in the sun. Do you have any suggestions for her on how she could improve that soil?
Oh, golly. You know, at first it sounded straightforward, because whether you have clay soil or sandy soil, the very best thing you can do is add compost to it. In the case of clay soil, which is so dense and waterlogged, the compost breaks it up so that water goes through it more readily. And if you have sandy soil, water runs right through it. So the compost kind of bulks it up so that it has more ability to sort of slow down the flow of the water movement through it. She's already using compost, which is frustrating. I think what I would recommend doing is, you know, keep doing what she's doing, but also leaving a mulch on top of the surface of the soil to help the soil hang on to its moisture and prevent those large cracks in it. I realize that's not a great solution, but it could be that it's drying out quickly on the surface of the soil and the mulch would cut down on that happening.
Do you have any suggestions for what kind of material she might want to use for the mulch?
Well, she can use grass clippings, provided she doesn't use things like weed and feed on the lawn. That typically contains herbicides that are for broadleaf plants and the majority of vegetable plants at the very least, and certainly flowers are broadleaf plants. And so if you have sprayed your lawn and then you mow it and move the clippings into this area that she's trying to improve, it will kill things growing in it. So, you know, gosh, it just seems like she's doing the right things. She might consider getting some weed-free straw and trying that on the surface of the soil. She's using leaves. You know, that's the thing. I mean, she's trying to do the right things. So I just have just those couple suggestions.
Now, while we're on the topic of soil, Carol Kozak was wondering how she can see what nutrients her soil might be lacking in, but she doesn't want to spend a lot of money on it and she doesn't want to send her soil off to be tested. So how else can she see what kind of nutrients she has or needs in her soil?
Okay, so first of all, there are some basic soil test kits that you can buy from garden centers. They're not greatly detailed as far as the information you get from them, but they will give you an idea, kind of like a snapshot of the amount of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium in your soil, and also what your soil pH is. The ideal pH range for growing veggies is between 5.5 and 7.5. So that would be sort of a basic test. The other thing is to be really observant about how well your vegetable plants grow and make sure that you're using the correct types of soil amendments. So, for example, if you're trying to grow a root crop like carrots, and you add a lot of nitrogen, such as manure, to the soil, that's going to promote leafy green growth rather than that root development. And of course, we're all wanting to harvest those roots. So in the case of carrots, you want to add something like bone meal, which is an organic soil amendment that's high in phosphorus, and that's what promotes root development. So she could do it that way, looking to see, you know, how are my plants growing and am I giving them the right nutrient? And then another thing she might consider doing is contacting her local master gardener program or her county's soil conservation district to find out what types of soil testing services are available in her area. A lot of times a detailed soil test costs maybe like about $30. And I don't think that's a hideous amount of money. But, you know, if she really needs some good detailed information, contact the master gardeners or the soil conservation district district, and they will point her in the right direction.
You know, I'm going to agree with you about getting the soil test done through the extension office. Even if it does cost a little bit of money, I always say it's one of the best investments that you can make in your garden for sure.
Yes, absolutely.
I also like what you said about observing how the plants are performing out there, because you can tell a lot about what the soil has to offer or what it's lacking in based on how the plants are doing.
Exactly. And, you know, I get a lot of questions from folks saying my tomato plants that, you know, they just look so lush and green and they did great, but I hardly got any tomatoes. You know, what's up with that? And so I ask them, I usually know what the answer is going to be. What kind of fertilizer are you using? And usually the answer is, oh, I've got something that's got all this nitrogen in it. Well, plants do need nitrogen, but if you want something to produce, both to bloom and produce fruits for you, whether it's tomatoes or cucumbers or squash, you definitely need to give them phosphorus type of a fertilizer. So again, bone meal or an organic vegetable fertilizer where that middle number on the fertilizer package is the highest, and that will solve the problem. So if someone is having issues with how a certain type of crop is growing, that a lot of times is what the problem is. They're just giving them the wrong nutrients.
Absolutely. Now, here's a fun question. So Sarah Davila, she was saying that when she starts her seeds, the little seeds themselves still stick to the baby plants after it sprouts. So she's curious if this indicates maybe that the seeds are bad in some way, or if she's doing something wrong when she's planting them. She says many of these plants where the seeds are still stuck to the young seedling, they don't make it. So she's wondering if there's a way that she can resolve this issue.
Right. And you know, that can be really common with certain types of plants. My husband loves growing peppers, and he deals with that a lot. But usually the two reasons that can cause the little seed coats to hold on to those new seedling leaves is either the seeds weren't planted at the right depth or the soil wasn't moist enough. Because usually what happens is that seed coat falls off of the plant after the seed germinates. And typically you don't have to do anything. But sometimes that seed shell holds on to both of the leaves. And that's really where you need to intervene, because it's going to impact the plant's ability to put out those true leaves. But you have to be so careful that you don't break the main stem or cause other damage to the seedlings. And so one thing that you might try is, before you try to take the seed coat off, try spritzing it with a little bit of water and see if that will help loosen it a little more easily.
I've also used a dropper to put just a little drop of water onto it to kind of soften it up, and that works sometimes as well.
That's a great idea.
So what do you suggest then? Let's kind of go off of that one. You'd mentioned that sometimes that's caused by not planting the seed at the proper depth. So how do we know what the proper depth to plant a seed actually is?
Well, there's multiple sources for that. Certainly, first and foremost would be the seed packet. And every now and then I end up with a seed packet that does not say that. And I think, okay, how am I supposed to be successful here? But generally speaking, your seed packet should say the depth to plant the seeds at. One of the things I've done on my website, which is susansinthegarden.com, is I created a planting guide for those kind of situations where it's all the most commonly grown vegetables. And it will say, you know, how deeply do you plant them? How far apart should you space them? How far apart should the rows be, and so on. So folks are certainly welcome to check that out. But generally speaking, it should be on the seed packet. And you can also contact your local Master Gardener program. They'd be happy to answer the question as well.
It sounds like your website's quite the resource, and that was susansinthegarden.com. And I'm going to put that link in the show notes for everybody as well, so they could click on through and check that out.
That would be great, because, you know, my goal for my website, which I've had for quite a few years now, was to create a great resource for everybody. You know, it's free. There's nothing on there that costs any money. And I just want gardeners to be successful. So that was one of the things that I thought would be helpful. I also have two guides, one based on zones 5 and 6, because that's what I garden in, and one is for all other zones, but it's when to start your seeds. So, you know, there's a lot of little things in there that should help.
Now, our last question today is going to be from Trisha Tolles of Greenville, Mississippi. Trisha wants to know, what are your best suggestions for companion planting? Maybe explain to the listeners a little bit what the companion planting is.
The idea behind companion planting is that you are planting two different types of plants together, whether it's, you know, two different kinds of vegetable crops or maybe vegetables and flowers, that type of thing. And sometimes a plant will help another plant grow better, and sometimes a plant will inhibit the growth of others. So many decades ago, there was a book that probably every gardener is familiar with, and it's called Carrots Love Tomatoes. And in it, the author shared her experiences and her conclusions on which types of plants would benefit each other in the garden. The problem is that so much of the information that she shared was anecdotal. And what I mean by that is that, you know, she wasn't conducting scientific tests where there were all these controlled elements so she would know for sure why two plants that grew next to each other did well in her garden. When you think about gardening, there's so many different variables. The weather, you know, we just talked about nutrients in the soil. Which nutrients were in there? Are there insect problems? Are there animal pest problems? And so on. And so when I think of companion planting, I like the ideas of planting things like aromatic herbs or flowers with insect or pest-prone plants. So things like onions, garlic, basil, rosemary, and so on within the beds of susceptible plants. Or doing something like the Three Sisters method where corn, pole beans, and squash are grown together. So the corn plants are supporting the upright growth of the beans, and the beans and corn plants are shading the squash plants so they can grow. So those would be examples of companion planting. Now, I'm not trying to diss the Carrots Love Tomatoes book. It's just that I want folks to realize that those weren't scientific experiments. And again, there's so many variables. But I did want your listeners to know that there is an excellent, fairly new book that is science-based on companion planting, and it's called Plant Partners by Jessica Walliser. And it is so well worth reading. So that's what I would suggest folks look at, because it really goes into depth about why certain plants do well with others and why some plants, this is really fascinating to me, will inhibit the growth of others.
That's called Plant Partners. I'm going to find that link and put it in the show notes as well, so folks can check that out. I'm interested in that book for myself. Now, for the folks that want to connect with you and maybe even pick up a copy of the Vegetable Garden Problem Solver Handbook or any of your other books, what are the links that they're going to need?
So my website, and I always say this slowly because people don't realize there's an S way in the middle. So it's susansinthegarden.com. So susansinthegarden.com. So that's my website. I post daily to Facebook and Instagram. And of course, that is Susan's in the Garden. And then I probably am best known for my weekly videos on all kinds of gardening topics. I have over 500 videos now, and that is the YouTube channel called, surprise, Susan's in the Garden.
Oh, I never would have guessed it. Susan, this was awesome. Thank you so much for taking the time to share your knowledge with everybody and answer all of these questions. This was super fun.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it. And it's just fun to talk about gardening with another gardening aficionado.
Well, looks like we found our way to the end of another show. Thanks again to Susan Mulvihill for being our guest today, and to all of you for tuning in. Remember, if you'd like to support the show, you can always join our Patreon community. You can find that link and many others at seedsandweedspodcast.com. This show was edited and produced by all of us here at Small House Farm, and the music we're enjoying right now is Funk in the Kingdom by Nira Flo. Thanks again for being with us. I'm your host, Bevan Cohen. Happy gardening, my friends.